lost and all alone. No one hit your phone up, your internet is slow. There's a place you can go and you can call home. When you're kinda blue and outside it's raining, Spotify your favorite dudes. There's a place you can go and you can call home. One big family, not just you and me. BARONG family loves ya, best gang in the world. From China to The Hague, from Bali to LA, family matters.
So we got Radical Redemption in the studio right now. A brand new episode of BARONG Family Radio. And as soon as I open up my YouTube account, you see only primitive survival tools, secret of primitive, building a pool with an underground house. Do you watch a lot of YouTube?
I'm this Jeske Vet. I don't, do you know Jeske Vet? The Dutchies will know,
like
Jeske Vet.
Comedy and shit.
Yeah. I like a lot of comedy stuff. So probably when you open my YouTube tab, it will say Jeske Vet or Tom Segura.
What's that?
It's a really nice stand-up comedian from the United States, I think. Tom Segura, a sarcastic fella.
Can I watch it on Netflix?
It's
as well?
On Netflix, yeah? Yeah. Two shows on Netflix, yeah.
Cool.
Should watch it if you like a bit of sarcastic, dark side humor.
That's my humor.
Yeah, me too. It's only the downside is that a lot of people don't understand that kind of humor. So when they see me for the first time, and I'm making jokes, and like the people that know me are like ha ha ha, and the people that don't know me are like, this dude, I don't like him.
Yeah, but like that's probably just the same like with the typical stoner movies. It's so not funny.
Yeah.
It's so stupid
that it's funny.
Really
yeah.
funny.
Yeah, yeah.
And I always like those movies as well.
Yeah,
so
too.
It's probably the same with comedy.
Seth Rogen.
Hey, but let's start at the beginning for a little bit. We met like a year ago.
Something like that. Yeah.
Yeah. Right.
And then Mexico.
And then we did the Mexico show, Wish Outdoor.
Yeah.
That was actual for me the first face-to-face meet, right? Because
yeah.
you met Jim before.
Yeah.
And then we ran into each other in Spain.
Yeah.
Wasn't it? And that was actually the first time I heard like 10, 15 minutes of your set. I was like, whoa, shit.
This is rough stuff.
This is loud.
Yeah, it's not for the faint-hearted.
No.
Yeah. This is when a lot of older people ask me what kind of music I do. It's like, well, set it as your alarm clock in the morning and you'll wake up immediately. Like for the 40 plus people that are like sometimes picking you up from the hotel, bring you to the venue, right? And they're like,
yeah.
Oh, you do EDM kind of stuff. I'm like, mwah. It's not really EDM-y. It's called hardstyle, you know? And they're like,
the thing is, it is EDM, but because it's electronic dance music, but EDM has such a like easy listening ring to it nowadays.
Yeah,
like,
yeah. It has a lot of breaks. I think nowadays they are really searching for the crossover between like the poppy stuff and the radio stuff and also the band stuff and the crossover with electronic music. And for example, I think like someone like Calvin Harris, I can really enjoy that kind of music. Also seeing him experimenting with blending styles and that kind of stuff.
Mm.
But for the other side, the stuff you guys do, and also for example, Moxie, you know, I'm a big Moxie fan.
Mm-hmm.
It's also experimenting with different kind of bass, but also rhythm. You guys have like a lot of those percussive. I'm a drummer,
mm-hmm.
so I'm immediately really triggered by the percussion and that kind of stuff in your music.
Yeah.
So, yeah, that's EDM. Yeah, electronic dance music. It's so general.
Yeah.
That it's everything and it's nothing. You know.
But that's the beauty of it nowadays.
Yeah.
Like I always call it like, when people say EDM, okay, then they think of house. I get that.
Yeah.
I always say bass music because it's everything.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's I think it's what you do. It's what, because
bass
it's,
music,
it all surrounds around, you know, bass. That was like a year ago, and this is a funny thing because on the download you work with Jim on a song.
Yeah.
And I found out about that because on YouTube somebody sent me a link like, hey, dope, you got a song with Radical Redemption. I was like, No, I don't think so. I think that's a hoax. And then I sent Jim a text. I was like, did you work on something with Joey? He's like, yeah. Oh shit, I forgot to tell you. I was like, okay, dope.
Thanks, man.
So it was like the first time I heard that we're working on something because you were because you played like a demo thing, right?
Yeah, we worked
on with Jim. Was on YouTube. On Instagram. It was super funny.
But like the response from the audience is like, because I really liked your track Beast Mode.
Mm-hmm.
And so we put that kind of vibe for the first drop. And then it also switches with like the vocal Radical Redemption. And then it goes into hard, radical kicks in your face. But because it's 160 BPM, it's playable for you guys. It's also playable for me and it's credible for me. And I really like
it. Is that your BPM?
My BPM normally is 155.
155.
Yeah. But I also saw that the Beast Mode track was also 160.
Yeah.
And the thing is, sometimes I can easily pitch it up to 160, play the track, and then go back to 155, 157. Yeah. But normally, when I'm closing, I'll end my sets at 190.
Oh,
200,
really?
Yeah. Not when I'm in the middle, not in the middle of the day,
no.
When they book me as a closing act, and because I also really, really, really love hardcore.
Uh-huh.
So I did also collaborations with, for example, Angerfist. And for me, I really like to have like a lot of music to play, to be able to play during the day. Like they can book me at 1 o'clock on a festival and at 5, but also as the last act.
Hey, and you're always live, right? Or you DJ a lot as well?
Yeah, well, the thing is, the live act for me, that's when I put on the suit.
Mm-hmm.
That's the thing I want to do exclusively like 10 times a year.
Okay. Yeah, I didn't know that.
Yeah, but the thing is, the times you saw me play,
you were in a suit.
I was
like abroad. For the listeners, he was wearing a pink leotard,
Bugs Bunny
high heels, Bugs Bunny ears, and this sort of like purple bulletproof vest. No, I'm kidding. No, yeah, exactly. I only saw you with the vest, so I actually thought that was. But okay, so those are.
So like the
then you're playing live.
Yeah, that's a live act
with
that's
a laptop.
Laptop Ableton.
Ableton.
I play with Ableton with the Akai.
Mm-hmm.
So
that's a controller, right?
Yeah, that's a controller. Yeah, and then it's. The freaking can begin for the real producer studio freaks under us. They know what I mean. It's you can do whatever you want with Ableton.
Yeah, because playing live is pretty well known in, I would say, the techno scene.
Yeah.
Not really in the hard style hardcore scene, right?
No, it's like Angerfist does it, Crypsis does it. I do it this way. That's because Angerfist and Crypsis, they're both from the same little village I grew up in, Denenkamp, it's called, in the eastern part of the Netherlands.
Yeah.
So when I wanted to do something live, my first approach was approach them, because I saw them standing on stage sometimes with a laptop.
Yeah.
And that's how I got introduced to Ableton and the live mixing with a mixer and doing freaky stuff.
Because were you already using Ableton to make your music?
No, I hate it for making music. I know a lot of
that's
people
interesting.
Love it. I really don't like it. I've been a Cubase kind of guy, and that's especially because I really like the audio editing.
Yeah.
So for people listening that don't know about producing, you can cut something and paste it and reverse it, and you can do everything within like one.
Yeah, it's very intuitive.
Yeah.
My buddy Tom uses it a lot. So I know how it looks. I know where everything is, but it's very hard for me because I don't know all the shortcuts.
Yeah,
I can work in Logic. I can work in Fruity, like pretty much the same way. For me, it's the same. But I know a lot of, because I know Looney Tunes use it.
Yeah.
And a lot of guys in the harder stuff.
Yeah.
For some reason, they all use that.
Yeah.
Or what's that other thing? Like
now you could also cut them Studio One.
Studio One.
That's like the love child between Logic and Cubase. I think a couple of developers from Cubase and Logic they went together and they made this hybrid, perfect kind of.
Have you ever worked in it?
I did. I don't think it's that perfect. I'm sorry, guys. Studio One. No, but I'm so stuck on Cubase for me because it's in my head. I'm in my studio like 60 hours a week, and for me that's just about the time I have to spend on learning that program again and
switching is a lot. Why would you
why?
Do it?
It makes no sense. Yeah,
no.
It's just fine as it is.
But you have certain geeks that just like love the technology and everything, right? So they were like, oh shit, there's a new program. Okay, let me see what this is about. And then they learn everything about it in like 5 days. Yeah, and they're like, fuck. So you're doing a big fucking show this Saturday, right?
Yes.
It's and the name of it.
Yeah.
Reminded me of a game.
Yeah,
I played.
I played it too.
A young dude.
I played it too.
You played it too.
Yeah. Well, the thing is, like,
we did that game, man. Command and Conquer.
Yeah, yeah. The thing is, I'm always doing my kind of stuff in. It's not only army themed, but the people that know what Radical Redemption does. So at first I did my first Heineken musical show in 2015. Then that was the Woman Army. Then in 2016 I did Militant Mayhem. Mm-hmm. And 2017 we moved to a bigger location. There's a new one in Brabant, in Breda.
You served in the army?
No, I did not. No.
You could. You look like it.
There's a lot of people saying, I wish you were not my sergeant. But, you're fine. No, I really did not. But I really like the whole... it's maybe superhero theme is not the right word, but I really like the epic cinema, big movie. Also, music-wise, I really like to do
just
movie scores.
Just everything you think about when you think about army or like
this, you know, like the big epic figure in a movie. That's really the approach I really like. I love for years, and that's also when I came up with the live suit. So the live act is what we set up. We talked about with the laptop, Ableton, the controller. But for a lot of people, there isn't really something different to see. So that's when I came up with, okay, so when I'm doing a live act, I'm going to play with a suit on.
Mm-hmm.
And my first suit was really inspired on Bane, the Bane figure from the Batman.
Yeah, I saw that.
So that's when I had...
Isn't it on the cover or something?
It's on the cover of my second album, The Spell of Sin. That was my first suit. It was like...
It's fucking scary. Dude.
Yeah, yeah. It was the first suit, so it was like... I was really happy with that suit. But when you look at that suit right now, you're like, oh, okay, could have been better, but okay. It's also the charm of something you do for the first time, you know? Mm. But then I really had like also the band on my... Like, it was... Yeah, it was around the face, around the ears, and then I had this like mask on,
oxygen mask.
But it was still a bit like, okay. Mm-hmm. And then for the 2015 show, we made like a full armor, body armor,
sick.
Like a metal LED lighting in it, and then we put like a real F-16 oxygen mask with also a light in it and that kind of stuff.
I love it.
Yeah,
honestly, I love it. I love that. I just love that little bit of extra and just showmanship. Let's listen to a couple songs.
Yeah.
And let's pick out like three or four. I think one of them should be Show Tech. Fuck the System.
Yeah.
Let's just listen to it. And could you name like three other songs you would like to listen to?
This is gonna sound crazy, but this is the music I grew up with. Some Fly Me to the Moon, Frank Sinatra.
Okay, dope. I would definitely want to hear something from you with a story. 100%.
Yeah, that's that will be for me the darkest moment. That's
darkest moment.
That's a track of myself that I made in December, and it really talks about like,
so last year.
Yeah, so last December, and it will also be on the upcoming album. That really tells about my personal story. I don't really like to do a lot of tracks with really personal thing in it, because it makes you kind of vulnerable or something.
Mm.
But this time, there was just a lot of shit happening. My mom and dad got divorced. My sister got divorced. We're huge financial problems with my dad's company because of the crisis, and I had to all like... Yeah, help everyone out and
tough.
That kind of stuff. And it was that took like 7 or 8 years already. And at some point, I was just only touring away, making music. And my little brother bought a home, and I missed it. And my sister had a divorce, and I wasn't there for her because I was away.
Life.
Yeah, and
life.
Eventually I was like, what am I doing right now? What's happening? And eventually that's why I made the song The Darkest Moment, because I couldn't really explain to people what I felt and what it was, so I made a track about it too. And that's what I also let my mom and dad and my family listen, and my closest friends, to like, okay, this is how I feel at the moment. And for me, I dealt with it, and within a month or so I was like back on track again. But that's for me, that was my way to express my feelings, and that's also one of the times I really told the fans about it. Also with a bit, normally I post a track and then it's a track, you know. Mm-hmm. But now it, I felt it also really needed my explanation and my backstory,
yeah,
for people to really understand what this track was about. I have to add two more tracks, but it will have nothing to do with the music I make.
Cool.
But for sure it will be Hotel California from the Eagles.
Okay.
And Hans Zimmer with the Inception team. It's I know it's maybe a bit like, okay, Inception thing, but the way he made that track with so few, like the main thing, it's so few notes.
Mm-hmm.
And people think, like a lot of times they think like how crazier the better. No. And also when you listen to the music he made for Interstellar, that's just, I think it's 4 or 5 notes. He did the whole score with that, and
it's
just
amazing,
building,
right? Yeah,
on those
just
4 or 5 notes. Yeah, and yeah, it's only escapes and swells and that kind of stuff. So yeah,
I get that. I get, yeah, what you're saying, like Hans Zimmer and everything. A bunch of guys on the label, like Mike Cervello, went to, because he played in Holland, right?
Yeah, Ziggo Dome.
Yeah, exactly.
I was there.
You was there as well?
Yeah, I was there.
They,
yeah,
went. They told me it was amazing.
It was a really good, yeah, show. Yeah.
Okay, we're gonna. Okay, cool. So, like, also a little preview of new music then.
Yeah.
Sick. Let's do it.
Are the most lonely. You know, you're working 13 to 15 hours a day. You don't really have that much time for a life outside of your work. When I was at my darkest moment, when I was about to make Face to Face, no one was there with me. I was completely alone. It's two sides of the coin, really. It's scary sometimes. When I was at my darkest moment, when I was about to make Face to Face, no one was there with me. I was completely alone. It's scary sometimes.
Freaks on E, that's what we fuck, man.
moon, let me play among the stars. Let me see what spring is like on Jupiter and Mars. In other words, hold my hand. In other words, baby, kiss me. Fill my heart with song and let me sing forevermore. You are all I long for, all I worship and adore.
So I have a bunch of questions, like short questions actually. Yeah. I just want to know, and I think the people listening really like to know. So what's your favorite holiday spot?
Bonaire. Yeah.
You go there a lot?
Since 3 years I go there every January.
Every January.
Yeah, and my uncle lives there.
Good.
So I'm going to visit my uncle and his boyfriend, his man, I don't know if it's official, but they're together for 25 years, so...
Pretty official.
Well, yeah, pretty official. Official. I don't know if there's a ring on a finger, I don't think so, but partners, yeah. So I really like to visit my uncles there.
Dope.
And just Curaçao is next door. Too busy for me, I know. Mm-hmm. I know myself. I will be partying all day. I can't use it. I have to chill then. So
there's a happy hour and a party every day at Curaçao.
That's why I'm going to Bonaire. It's really like the best choice for me. Yeah.
How many times you take a holiday a year?
I haven't been on a holiday for 5 years, and then I took my first one in 2016.
That's insane.
Yeah, that's also when my dad and mom told me, and now you're going on a fucking holiday because you're not gonna do this for two or three years.
But now you got the hang of it.
Now, after that one, the first one, and I was like, okay, what have I been doing?
So important, man.
Yeah, it is. Yeah.
But it's like you have to like almost have to learn it. Yeah. Learn it to like, and not to give myself a compliment, I've became really good at it.
But I'm always like getting sick. Like the first first 3 or 4 days,
yeah,
I'm getting the flu, sick, shivering, that kind of stuff.
It's your body just thing. Like relaxes, right? Yeah, everything's like, okay, now I can like take care of myself.
Yeah, and then the other 6 days I'm there, I'm like in my happy place.
Yeah.
And then I'm like, the thing is, when I have to go, like when I'm leaving, I don't want to go. I'm like, oh no, I cannot go on a vacation. Not right now. I have to do this.
Phone calls.
And then when I have to leave and go back home again, and then I'm like, oh no, I don't want to leave. I want to stay here. Yeah. So yeah.
That's how it all is.
So it works.
Are you signed or are you like independent?
I'm signed.
You're signed. Is it your own label or are you signed to like a bigger label?
I think the biggest label right now in the hardstyle scene, Minus Is More, is it called. Mm-hmm. And when they started, and it's 10 years ago now, it was the label that did within the hard dance scene, did whatever they wanted. And even if you wanted to do a drum and bass track, release it. We don't care.
Dope.
And
you, so kind of like the Barong mentality.
Yes.
But then in your scene.
Yeah.
Dope. Are you a UFC fan?
I'm a hockey fan.
Ice hockey fan. Okay.
LA Kings. I've been to. I had to play in Canada last week. I immediately bought tickets for the Vancouver Canucks against the Penguins. So, yeah, I love it, man.
Oh, ice hockey.
Ice hockey. Yeah, yeah.
I was like, hockey?
No.
Okay, but I was about to say
NHL.
Less aggressive than your music style, but no. Like ice hockey is like brutal.
It's the best, man.
Yeah.
And especially we as a soccer country, like like the continent of soccer.
Compared to that shit, we're pussies.
Yeah, then like Ronaldo starts whining when you look at his ankle on the wrong way, and then the hockey players just fucking beat the shit out of each other, and then they shake hands and they're like, okay, let's continue.
Real man. Real fucking man. I've never been to a game, but should definitely go then.
Yeah, and especially, for me, especially go to the LA Kings.
Okay.
Because also in the Staples Center, the whole vibe, the show.
I've been there to American. A basketball game though.
Yeah, and for me, the basketball game is like, the score is 120 against 108. It's like, is it even special to score anymore, you know? So that's why I really like ice hockey, because it's like soccer, the soccer matches, but yeah, it's, soccer will be 2-0 and ice hockey will be 4-2, 5-2, something like that. Bit similar, so the goal, every score is still like an epic win.
It's like more exciting.
Yeah.
Yeah. the last question is, and we always ask this to everybody we're doing this show with. We want to play a Barong family classic. So maybe like one song that's a classic for you on the label.
Yeah.
I don't know if you have it on the top of your head. Could be like your favorite song or like.
I think it would be one of the first Moxie songs.
Barong family classic.
Honestly, thanks for your time because you're super busy right now. You're gonna rehearse the intro for the show this Saturday, and this is pretty cool because I'm free.
Really?
I'm gonna come out.
Oh, dude! And
if I'm allowed, and okay, if you have a spare ticket for me, I'm gonna come out.
But really, because then I got one question for you. I'm doing my opening from 1 till 2, and I'll put the first draft of our song in the opening.
Okay, that's sick.
Will you come on stage or not?
Of course, do it together. Of course, dude. Yeah? If I'm there, I have to. Okay, that's sick. Good shit, dude. Good shit. I'm fucking excited, man. I never really witnessed a show like that. So this is going to be cool.
Awesome, man. And thanks. Also, our Dolph will be there also.
Rutje, Dolphy. Ah, perfect.
Little shout out to Ruud because he's such a lovely guy.
That means two things. He's a fun guy, so it's good for the hangs, but also he can drive and I can drive.
Sorry, Sorry, kill.
Perfect.
Hey, what's up, guys? This is Dither, and you're listening to my guest mix on Barong Family Radio.
chaos! Let the carnage begin!
Yes!
For my next number, I'd like to return to the classics.
DJ.
mode. Give me those beats, I eat those. All day, I don't sleep, no. I don't even know what I got sheets for. Them pillowcases and bed frames, I'll not take that, don't need those. So high, I don't get high. I don't even know what I got weed for. I'm in beast mode, I'm in beast mode, I'm in beast mode.
To check out my hardcore rave EP on Barong Family, which is out now.
I'ma be a raver till the motherfucking day I die.
motherfucking day.
Weird music. What is this?
this is... I'm sick! You're all sick!
make noise.
Drop the bass.
This is it. Thanks for listening to my guest mix on Barong Family Radio. See you guys later. Peace.